China actually everybody was in hospital till the virus completely cleared. There was no suggestion that, okay, you feel well enough, please just sit home in isolation for 3 weeks. They were not let out of the hospital till they showed 2 negative coronavirus tests. And they would never discharge patient with positive coronavirus test to go home and just finish your treatment. Here are your prescription, follow the rules, free up your bed to somebody else. Nothing like this. So 2 negative tests. You know what was found after this negative test? That's all in PubMed. It's all already published papers. I'm citing those papers. It was found that 2 people who get 2 tests negative on 2 different days, so it's not just test taken twice, it's on 2 different days, and their both tests are negative with a space day between those 2 tests, so it took 3 days to test. If they get discharged, they have 14% chance to get back into the hospital with the next 2 weeks with coronavirus. So coronavirus was actually not cleared, and it had to be tested for 3 times. That is the golden standard. Golden standard in China. You test 3 times on 3 different days with a spacer between those days. So it will test you a week. In 3 different days of a week, you all 3 times negative. Mm-hmm. Only after this you go home. This is proper discharge. If you are simply saying, take this bag of drugs and here is your prescription, follow the course prescribed by doctor, do it at home, you are breeding the virus and releasing the virus into the population. Mutated virus after enhanced evolution, which happened during stay in the hospital after the treatment with all those drugs. Of course, we should continue treating patients. Please don't understand me in a way that, oh, let's not treat anybody because we will have otherwise a lot of mutants. We will still get them, even if we will do this horrible thing. But we need to be aware of the process of the treatment from molecular biology standpoint and what exactly we are doing, because that's giving us means to control the process. Of course, I understand that's a lot of resources, and that means 3 tests, and also it means that probably if you have patients who are sick already for a very long time and having evidence that there is an evolution of the virus in this patient, probably you need to do sequencing of the virus from the patient and then compare this virus with database, and you need to do it for many patients, and you need to have biologists, bioinformaticians who analyze situation in each hospital. I understand that it's very difficult to find resources for doing that. But China does. China was able to overcome virus using this strategy. And we now need to implement those kind of strategies again. And I want to stress on yet another thing. We are putting a lot of blame around right now. We're saying, okay, this is UK virus. Like, remember in the beginning, we were like, oh, Chinese virus came to us, yes, from China. Now all evil come from England.
Yes, we are now isolated. No flights, borders are closed.
Suffering for nothing, because it wouldn't help. Because every country brewing their own viruses. I actually think that the UK did the absolutely brave thing with coming out with this, yes, to WHO, as every country would. As previously Danish minister spoke about the coronavirus in Minsk, of course, their action was to cause like total disaster for their mink population and for mink farmers. But anyway, saying about new strains of viruses is the right thing. What I'm saying is that I can imagine that there are countries which would be hesitant to report on the new strain of coronavirus by 2 reasons. First of all, nobody wants blame. And second, not enough resources. What you didn't measure, you couldn't report. Only the country with such a good surveillance system, like in UK, could be able to catch the virus which is spreading faster. For example, I'm in United States. In all fairness, coronavirus in United States is rampant. It's at much larger proportions than in UK. And it seems like nobody cares. Because we have other things to care right now, administration changes. And so I think that we would be on exactly the same plate as you, only at the end of January, when all this administration change would be over and realization would come that now we really should do something important. Yeah. stop doing little things and start doing big things. Please don't feel isolated. I would be very happy to share with everybody news about coronavirus, only I very much prefer to share good news. Today it looks like we covered a lot of bad stuff, but it's not the end of the world. And I'm just dying to say this to you. Keep calm and press on, yes? And hopefully the next news would be about how successful vaccine is.
Will the vaccine, the Pfizer vaccine, work on this variant of coronavirus?
That is a great question, and I think that nobody can have a very straightforward answer on this, but I will explain the biology so you would understand. So the protein which we are using for vaccination, this is S protein, spike protein of coronavirus. It's kind of large protein. And protein is like a very long sausage, which you can just tie in different kinds of knots. And so if you straighten it up, it will be like a long pole, very long pole. Imagine kids coming to the pole and starting to play this kind of game, going up the pole. So every place on this pole, which is roughly the size of the child hand, yeah, this is a place called epitope. When antibodies bind to the virus protein, they bind not throughout entire protein, but to particular epitope within the virus, here or here or here. So every place within the virus protein is an epitope. So imagine if mutations happen. Now our virus, a New England strain, have 19 different mutations or 21 different mutations, which make it different from original virus. Yeah, it looks like it's a lot, but there are substantially more epitopes or places where the child hand can get to the pole than those 19 or 21 places. Imagine this pole, it's grown a thorn in particular place, torn here, torn here, torn here. And the hand cannot go around the thorn, you will hurt yourself, yes? Mm-hmm. So in this very long pole, this place, that place, and yet another place would be not possible to bind. But all others will be still there. Now, when we are producing the neutralizing antibodies to the vaccine protein or to the natural coronavirus protein, not one antibody is produced, but many different antibodies. No, say like 5-6 different antibodies. Which kind of antibody will be made in particular person? We don't know. So throughout the population, it's 5-6 per person, but one person get those, another person those, so all together we can get like this on the top of this pole. Somebody would be more lucky than somebody else. If it happened that your particular antibody, by bad luck, you're exactly in the places where spikes are, where those thorns are, then it's bad luck. But we have 5 or 6 of them. What is the probability that all 5 or 6 will be eliminated? Mm. Not large probability, but it is possible to find some people like this. And of course, the immunity, which is due to 2 epitopes, is kind of weaker than immunity due to 6 epitopes. Agree?
Absolutely.
But it's not black and white situation. It's not like yes immunity or no immunity. This is the spectrum. There are a lot of shades in this spectrum. Let's look at this from populational numbers, like Pfizer, for example. Pfizer say we are 95% efficient against coronavirus disease, and we 100% efficient against protection against severe coronavirus disease. Say new strains came, and some people in population get so unlucky, very small amount, that they are now not protected. And some people, larger group of people, a little bit unlucky, so they are somewhat less protected. At the population level, we will see Pfizer numbers dropping, say from 95% to 91%, and 100% protection against severe coronavirus will be dropping to 98%. Well, I could say not bad. I'll take it. Give me 2 of those vaccines. Yes, I still take it. So it's not that bad. Let me remind you that in the very beginning, when we started the coronavirus vaccine race, the bar was set at 50%. So FDA and also European agencies, they say we would accept for review everything which protects more than 50%, which is about the functionality of the anti-influenza vaccine. And you see, Moderna and Pfizer came with much better numbers. It was really a moment of joy when I saw those numbers. So yeah, those numbers could become slightly less shiny.
So as a result, I think, Antje, you have protected our Christmas mood.
Yeah, I hope so.
Because everyone was very worried that our Christmas is going to be ruined. So I want to disregard this message and say that our Christmas is saved and we're going to be safe if we're going to continue to protect ourselves and use safety measures as before.
Absolutely.
So thank you very much for your thorough analysis, and definitely it does help us to understand this new strain a little bit more and calm us down before Christmas. Taking on this note, I would like to wish you a very great Christmas and New Year, and hope we're going to be healthier next year and we're going to be happier and our family is going to be safe and healthy.
So certainly. 2021 is not a leap year. 2020 was a leap year. Bad things happen during leap years. They're not happening during normal years. So 2020 is over and we move to the good 2021.
Thank you for your help in analyzing this coronavirus issues and symptoms and for all these educational videos that we have produced so far.
Thank you for having me and all your heavy editing work.
See you next year.